The 14th lecture on subject of nuclear physics, particles and antiparticles. The hypothesis of an antiparticle first arose in 1928. On the basis of the relativistic wave equation, Paul Dirac predicted the existence of a positron, discovered 4 years later by Anderson in the cosmic radiation. Electron and positron are not the only particle-antiparticle pair. On the basis of the relativistic quantum theory, they came to the conclusion that for each fundamental particle, there must exist an antiparticle. The principle of charge conjugation. Experiments show that for each particle, except for a photon and p meson, they correspond on antiparticle. Paul Dirac, awarded the Nobel Prize in 1933, and Carl David Anderson, awarded the Nobel Prize in 1936. From the general regulation of the quantum theory, it follows that the particle and antiparticles must have the same masses, the same lifetimes in vacuum, the same in modulus, but opposite in sign, electric charge and magnetic moments, identical spins and isospins, and the same remaining quantum numbers attributed elementary particles to describe the laws of their interaction, baryon number, strangeness, charm, etc. Until 1956, it was believed that there is a complete symmetry between particles and antiparticles. It was, if some process is going on between particles, then there must be exactly the same process with the same characteristics between antiparticles. In 1956, it is proved that this symmetry is a characteristic only of strong and electromagnetic interactions and is violated for the weak. According to Dirac's theory, the collision of a particle on an antiparticle must lead to their mutual annihilation, as a result of which other fundamental particles or photons arise. An example of this is the electron-positron pair annihilation reaction. After the theoretically predicted positron existence was confirmed experimentally, the question arose about the existence of an antiproton and an antineutron. Calculations show that to create a particle-antiparticle pair, it is necessary to expend energy exceeding twice the rest energy of the pair, since the particles need to report very significant kinetic energy. To create a proton and antiproton pair, an energy of about approximately 4.4 gigaelectronvolts is needed. The antiproton was indeed discovered experimentally in 1955 in the scattering of protons accelerated at the largest at the time synchrophototron at the University of California on the nucleons on the target nuclei. The target was copper, which produced a pair proton and antiproton. The antiproton differs from the proton by the strength of the electric charge and the intrinsic magnetic moment. The antiproton can annihilate not only the proton but also the neutron. Next formula, second formula, third formula. A year later, in 1956, on the same accelerator, it was possible to obtain an antineutron and carry out its annihilation. Antineutrons appeared as a result of a charge exchange of antiprotons during their motion through matter. The charge exchange reaction consists on the exchange of charge between a nucleon and an antinucleon and can be proceed according to next schemes. First scheme, second scheme. the antineutron differs from the neutron, and by the sign of the its intrinsic magnetic moment. If the antiprotons are stable particles, then the free antineutron. If it does not undergo annihilation, eventually undergoes decay according to schema. Antiparticles were also found for P plus mesons, kaons, and hyperons. However, there are particles that do not have antiparticles. There are so-called truly neutral particles. This includes the photon, the pi, the Rowney meson, and eta meson. Its mass is equal 1,074 multiplied electron mass, the lifetime of 7 complicate multiplied to 10 to minus 19 second. It decays with the formation of P mesons and gamma quanta. Truly neutral particles are not capable of annihilation, but experience mutual transformations, which are the fundamental property of all fundamental particles. We can say that each of the truly neutral particles is identical with its antiparticle. Great interest and serious difficulties were the proof of the existence of antineutrinos and the answer to the question of whether neutrinos and antineutrinos are identical or different particles. Using powerful antineutrino fluxes obtained of the reaction fission fragments of heavy nuclei undergo decay and emit antineutrinos. American physicists Rains and Cohen in 1956 reliably recorded the reaction of capture of electron antineutrinos by F proton. Similarly, the capture of electron neutrino by a neutron is fixed. Thus, these reactions were, on the one hand, an unsputable proof that electron neutrinos and electron antineutrinos are real particles and not fixation concepts introduced only to explain the beta decay, and on the other hand confirmed the conclusion that neutrino and antineutrino are different particles. Subsequently, experiments on the production and absorption of muon neutrinos have shown that muon neutrino and muon antineutrino are different particles. It is also proved that the pair electron neutrino and muon neutrino are different particles, and the pair electron neutrino and electron antineutrino is not identical to the pair muon neutrino and muon antineutrino. According to the idea of the Pantikova, the capture of the muon neutrino obtained by decay by neutrons was carried out, and the emerging particles were observed. It turned out that the reaction asterisk does not go and the capture takes place according to the scheme. That is, instead of electrons in the reaction, muons were produced. This confirmed the difference between electron neutrino and muon neutrino. According to modern ideas, neutrinos and antineutrinos differ from each other in one of the quantum characteristics of the state of an elementary particle, helicity, defined as a projection of the particle spin on the direction of its motion, per pulse. To explain the experimental data, it is assumed that for a neutrino, the spin S is antiparallel to the momentum P, etc. The direction P at S form a left screw, and the neutrino has a left helicity, figure A. In antineutrinos, the directions of P and S form a right-handed screw. It is antineutrino has a right helicity, figure B. This property is valid equally for both of electron and muon neutrinos, antineutrinos. In order for the helicity to be used as a neutrino-antineutrino characteristic, the neutrino mass must be assumed for to the zero. The introduction of helicity made it possible to explain, for example, a violation of the law of conservation of parity for weak interactions that cause the decay of fundamental particles and beta decay. Thus, the right helicity is attributed to be muon and to the muon plus nu muon to the left helicity. After the discovery of such a large number of the antiparticles, a new problem arose: to find the antinuclei, in the other words, to prove the existence of antimatter, which is constructed of antiparticles as well as matter from particles. Antinuclei were indeed discovered. The first antinucleus, an antideuteron, bound state antiproton and antineutron, was obtained in 1965. A group of American physicists under the leadership of Leon Max Lederman. Subsequently, the nucleus antihelium in 1970 and antitritium in 1973 were synthesized by the Serpukhov accelerator in the USSR. It should be noted, however, that the possibility of the annihilation when encountering particles does not allow antiparticles to exist for a long time among the particles. Therefore, for a stable state of antimatter, it must be isolated from the substance. If a cluster of antimatter existed near the known part of the universe, then powerful annihilation radiation would have to be observed, explosions with the release of the huge amount of energy. However, astrophysicists have not registered anything like this yet. Studies conducted to find antinuclei, ultimately antimatter, and the first successes achieved in the direction are fundamental importance for further knowledge of structure of matter. Hyperons, strangeness and parity of fundamental particles. The nuclear photoemulsions, late 40s, and charged particles accelerators 1950s, heavy unstable fundamental particles with a mass greater than the nuclear mass, called hyperons, from the Greek hyper, super higher, were found. Several types of hyperons are known: lambda, sigma, xi, and omega. The existence of the omega hyperon follows from the proposition in 1961 by the Murray Hellman, American physicist, Nobel Prize in 1969, scheme for the classification of strongly interacting fundamental particles. All of the particles known at that time fit into this scheme, but in there was one unfilled place which was supposed to occupy a negative charged particle with a mass of about 3,284 multiplied electron mass. And as a result of special experiment of omega minus hyperon with a mass of 3,284 electron mass was actually detected. Hyperons have mass in the range from 2,183 to 3,273 mass electrons. Their spin is 1/2, only the spin of omega hyperon is 3/2. The lifetime of is about 10 to minus 10 second for the omega hyperon. The lifetime is approximately 10 to minus 20 second. They participate in strong interactions. It is belong to the hadron group. Hyperons decay into nucleons and light particles, p mesons, electrons, neutrinos and gamma quanta. A detailed study of the creation and transformation of hyperons led to the establishment of a new quantum characteristic of fundamental particles, the so-called strangeness. Its introduction was necessary to explain a number of paradoxes from the point of the view of existing representation properties of the particles. The fact is that hyperons, showed as it seemed, have a lifetime of about 10 to minus 23 seconds, which is 10 to 13 times less than the established by experience. Such times of life can only be explained by the fact that the decay of hyperons occurs as a result of weak interaction. In addition, it turned out that at each time the hyperon is born in pair with the K meson. For example, a K0 meson is always produced in a reaction with a lambda hyperon, in the behavior of which the same feature are observed as a hyperon. The decay of the hyperon occurs according to the next theme. The behavior of hyperons and K mesons was explained in 1955 by Murray Gell-Mann with the help of the quantum number strangeness S, which is conserved in the processes of strong and electromagnetic interactions. If we assign the S equals 1 to the kaons and S equals minus 1 to the lambda and epsilon hyperons, and assume that the nucleons and p mesons have S equal 0, then the conservation of the total strangeness of the particles in the strong interaction explains how the joint production of the lambda hyperon K0 meson and the impossibility of the decay of particles with strangeness that is not equal to 0 due to the strong interaction on particles whose strangeness is 0. Reaction double asterisk goes with the violation of strangeness, so it cannot occur as a result of strong interactions. Xi hyperons, which are born together with two kaons, are assigned S equals minus 2. Omega hyperons, S equal minus 3. From the law of conservation of strangeness, follows the existence of particles such as anti-K meson, sigma 0, sigma xi, C0 hyperons, which were subsequently discovered experimentally. Each hyperon has its own antiparticle. Fundamental particles are attributed another quantum mechanical quantity, parity p, is a quantum number characterizing the symmetry of the wave function of a fundamental particle or a system of fundamental particles with respect to mirror reflection. If the wave function of the particle does not change sign under mirror reflection, then the parity of the particle p equals plus 1. Parity is positive. If it changes sign, then the parity of the particles is p equals minus 1 negative. From quantum mechanics follows the law of conservation of parity, according to which for all transformations undergone by a system of particles, the parity of the state does not change. The conservation of parity is associated with the property of mirror symmetry of space and indicates the invariance of the laws of nature with respect to the replacement of the right by the left, and vice versa. However, studies of K-meson